I'm very excited to introduce to everyone here Gene Beley. He's here today to talk to us about his adventure with Johnny Cash back at that and that fortuitous day when he played a little concert at Folsom Prison. Gene, welcome.
I'm so honored to be here today. I'm going to put you in the exact atmosphere that I experienced on January 13th, 1968. That's why we had the 1968 poster up here. We'll start by transporting all of you in a time machine from this luxury hotel cafeteria back to the Folsom Prison cafeteria in 1968. You know, it's pretty nearby here, so you can be glad you aren't eating in that cafeteria. You'll hear the voice of Hugh Cherry, a well-known Los Angeles DJ who was the concert's MC on that historic day, talking to the prisoners, getting them to feel like they were really a part of what was going to be a historic recording, although none of us knew it was going to be historic. And then he introduced the first warm-up act was Carl Perkins, who many of you are too young to know or don't remember songs like I do, like Blue Suede Shoes. I've heard predictions that people will still be talking about this album 100 years from now. And I'd like to show you what I just got a shipment today. I had a part in recording the night before rehearsal at the Hotel El Rancho the night before. And since I was the only one who recorded it, I was able to sell it to Sony in January, and they just came out with this new box set album. So I'm pretty excited to be able to bring this and just show you guys today. And I even got a credit on the album to show my grandchildren and my nephew, who's the videographer today. I gave him one of these. So, Janelle, we can cut to the first intro audio track with Hugh Cherry and introducing Carl Perkins.
Thank you very much, gentlemen. We'd like to thank you and the warden and Coach Kelly for the opportunity of coming here and recording an album. My name is Hugh Cherry. I'm a radio man from down in Los Angeles. And along the way, as you probably know, Johnny Cash will be recording an album here. And there's pretty obvious reasons for it. One of the most important is that John has written a lot of songs that have dealt with prison, and he wanted to do an album that had the feel of the men in it, the songs that, with which they identify. And along the way, if you hear something you like, we want you to respond. We want you to react in whatever manner you're motivated to do. If you like it, you let us know. And I kind of imagine along the way you will find some things which you're going to like. John brought his entire act with him, and he brought some very, very talented people. Among them is the gentleman who wrote quite a number of the first songs that with which Elvis Presley gained international popularity, not the least of which was Blue Suede Shoes. Here's Mr. Carl Perkins.
And that was only the beginning. Everyone always asked me, how did you meet Johnny Cash? I was a newspaper back then, 1968, for the Ventura Star Free Press. I got a call one night from Dan Poush, the chief photographer, who he and I would team up to do national magazine articles. And Dan said, Gene, you and I have been invited to go to Folsom Prison with Johnny Cash. So I was a little more conservative than Dan, and I guess because a lot of you are too young maybe to know much about Johnny Cash, back in 1968 he was really on the skids. He had been arrested for smuggling pep pills in his guitar across the Mexican border. And there had been nothing but negative stories about him for quite a few years. our local, he lived right outside of Ventura for quite a few years with his first wife, Vivian, and four children. One of them, of course, who's become very famous, Roseanne Cash. My favorite bad story about him that one of the previous editors had written is when he put some loudspeakers on his house in Casita Springs. And I think we've got a picture of the house. When the Christmas music went up that year, the neighbors complained, the sheriff came out, pulled the plug, and the headline was something like, Johnny Cash has a blue Christmas. A lot of people think that John actually was an inmate in Folsom Prison, and that's not true. Because if he had had a felony, he wouldn't have been allowed inside Folsom. He did spend one night in the El Paso jail and got a 30-day suspended sentence. Another place where he spent a night in jail, I think for drunkenness, or they found him out on the lawn someplace. That sheriff went home that night, and when he told his wife, she cried all night. So when he went back to the jail, he released John and said that his wife was crying all night, and I don't ever want to see you in my jail again. I think we've got a picture of his home in Casita Springs. So we got that to show him? That was just right outside of Ventura, and his parents lived down the roadways, and that's where I ended up meeting him. But back on, you know, how I actually met him. When I asked Dan, who invited us? And that's when the reply was unbelievable. He says, well, I was at this New Year's Eve party, and I met one of his best friends, a minister. That was so incongruous at the time. I almost asked Dan what he was smoking. And so I told Dan, I said, I kind of like to meet the minister before we go. He said, okay, I can arrange that. And that's when I met the Reverend Floyd Gressett, who was a minister of a Ventura church called the Community Avenue Church that you see on the screen here. And Reverend Gressett's hobby was ministering the prisoners in California. And when he talked to the DJ inside the walls of Folsom Prison, when that DJ found out that he knew Johnny Cash, that's when it started to gel. And so the recreation director at Folsom, Lloyd Kelly, worked with Reverend Gressett to start producing the concert. And it was not an easy sell to Columbia Records. They thought it was a little too far out. It wouldn't do anything for his image since he had all this, you know, bad things happen to him in the past. But John was a pretty good salesman, and he ended up prevailing. Reverend Gressett said that John and June Carter were coming to visit his daughters and his parents before leaving for Folsom Prison, and that I should just meet him at his parents' home in Oakview. So that's where I first saw John. He wasn't there at first, and he and June Carter, I mean, they were out for a walk, so the first time I saw him, he was dressed in the same outfit you see him here, blue blazer. I mean, really nice, looking like a movie star, just walking down the road. And, you know, having grown up in the 50s in high school and remembering some of his songs, I have to confess that I was a little starstruck. But John was so down to earth. Everything I asked him to do, every picture I asked him to do, totally, you know, was totally helpful to me. And one of my favorite pictures is John arm wrestling his nephew at the kitchen table. So showing him just as an uncle. By the way, this was in the Johnny Cash calendar last year, along with quite a few other of our photos. But that's probably my all-time great. And even see the calendar on the wall says January. I mean, it couldn't be. It was almost like I staged it, but I didn't. Another one that I don't have to show you is I had him swinging his nephew out in the backyard. And then we also took one of his family with him. I think that may be the next one. Yeah. So left to right is his father, Ray Cash, who was a very short man. And if any of you saw the movie, I Walk the Line, I was really upset that they made Ray Cash look out, made him look really bad. Well, I couldn't hardly get two words out of him. He was a totally nice guy. So I know the movie took some poetic license to do that or not, but he was a nice guy. And his sister Reba there was a beautiful lady, and she was his business manager. And then Carrie Cash's mother, you can see where he got his bone structure from and his height. And I think we've got another photo of him and his mother coming up holding a Johnny Cash album. This is another favorite of mine because, again, it shows a proud mother from, you know, she was just a humble lady from Arkansas, you know. I mean, just picture every woman here. I want you to just picture if that was your son, you would be beaming. And even though at that time he was on the skids, she was still the proud mother. Another story I can tell you, but, you know, while you're looking at this album, John told me a story once about he was in a New York record store and he couldn't cash a check. So he had to go get a record album out of the rack to prove his identity. Anyhow, after, another thing I was going to intersperse here is I had a problem with June Carter because as a family newspaper reporter, she was the other woman back then. And, you know, where his first wife and family lived just up the road, and they would be our target type market. I never took one picture of June that day, which I regret to this day. Because I got to know her, and she was such a wonderful woman. I enjoyed her comedy. I mean, she was such a natural-born comedian. We're lucky that we're on our own time, and because later years, the newspaper tried to claim that they owned the photos. And I'd like to read, this is kind of impromptu. I'm throwing Janelle off the track here for sure. But later we had the city editor, 2 years before he died, he wrote me this nice letter. He said, "This is to confirm that when you attended the Folsom Prison concert with the Reverend Floyd Gressett, Johnny Cash, June Carter, and Ray Cash, you did so on your own time and at your own expense and not as an assignment for the Ventura County Star Free Press. Although I used your article and photos of the January 13, 1968 experience in the Sunday magazine, it is almost humorous in retrospect that the late Joe Paul, then managing editor, was not that keen about featuring Johnny Cash at Folsom Prison. My children were classmates of the Cash girls of Ventura's Holy Cross School, and it was interesting to see the impact of the Folsom Prison concert on Johnny Cash's career and lasting success with even the younger generations today." So that's our, you know, someone asked me, John here, it's our AT man. He asked me if I had copyrights to it. I said no, because back then we didn't realize we needed copyrights. But if anyone tried to take us to court today to say that we didn't take the picture, I would get him laughed out of court in 3 minutes with that letter, plus just a parade of other things. Well, back on track for Janelle, the Associated Press has made our photos world famous. The one report shows them going into the Encyclopedia Britannica, Oakland Press, Sarasota Herald Tribune, KNBC TV, NBC News, and even the South China Morning News, amongst many other media outlets. And I think I just got another report today where it shows that it went into some Spanish publication, four different ones, so LA Times, the CBS Special Assignments in New York, KTVU TV, NBC News, and NBC must have had about six or seven stations on it. So it's been interesting for that one day. I was just telling one of the people at the table here that what I've gotten out of all this is you never know when one day in your life will become more significant than all the other days in your life. So you should try and do your best every day, because like we weren't getting paid that one day, yet that one day turned out to be the most profitable day in our lives. Nell's going to show another rather humorous historical relic I've saved of the PSA Airlines. Round trip ticket between Los Angeles and Sacramento was only $32. When we stepped off the plane in Sacramento, because Dan Poush, the photographer, and I met John and June at the PSA Airlines counter and flew with them in the same plane to Sacramento. And when we stepped off that plane, it was just a perfect California blue sky day like today. And when June Carter got off the plane, I'll never forget her charming southern voice said, "Oh, this is just a great huckleberry picking day." I just loved to hear her talk. She kept us all laughing. She grew up with a fairly talented family. Her mother, Maybelle Carter, and her father, Ezra Carter, were the founders of country western music. She was really more famous than him at that particular time. Ezra acted as the manager of the Carter family act, with Maybelle playing the auto harp and banjo, while her sister, Anita, she had such an angelic voice. I don't think I've heard any better voice than her sister's, Anita's voice. So June felt kind of inferior to the rest of her talented family. And that's why she kind of became a comedian to get attention in the act. We all waited in line that day after we got off the plane, just like anyone else, to get a limousine. Nobody recognized John and June. That kind of surprised me, because, you know, John had had a lot of big hits in the 50s. And it also seemed like they're pushing some people to the head of the line, and those must have been the superstar politicians we have here in Sacramento, right? Finally, we got a limo to the motel, which was the Hotel El Rancho, which is kind of interesting. It's turned into a Buddhist retreat today. It's kitty corner from the West Sacramento City Hall. June listened to these letters and code words to the limo driver, and she said that must be those people still standing in line cussing. We stayed at the Hotel El Rancho, and that afternoon, while we were waiting for the rest of the band to arrive, John was kind of nervous about it because there's bad weather. And so we were sitting around the motel room, and Reverend Gresset said, "John, I promised this woman you would listen to this demo tape." And he asked, "You know, what is it?" I think it was Gresset that said, "It's written by an inmate in Folsom Prison." He didn't tell him it was a bank robber. "Anybody got a tape recorder?" Big John asked. I raised my hand. "Well, go get it." So I brought it in my big old Sony tape recorder, reel-to-reel tape recorder that I had brought for research, and never dreaming how valuable that tape recorder would be. Like I say, it's led to this album that's just being released this week for National Record Day. But once we started, put that little demo tape on my tape recorder and started it, it was like we all touched a bare electrical wire with electricity.
"Inside the walls of prison, my body may be, but my Lord has set my soul. There's a gray stone chapel here in Folsom, a house of worship in this innocent. You wouldn't think God had a place here in Folsom. They save the soul of many lost men."
I began kidding John, "If they let this guy out of prison, he'll put you out of business." And so that's when John says, "Bring that to my room. I want to copy down the lyrics and sing that song tomorrow." Much later, I thought to myself, "Who am I telling Johnny Cash?" Something like that. But I think John got used to me saying outrageous things. And later, I'll tell you another story of something outrageous that I said that he recorded on another famous album. Dan fortunately took that photo of John copying down the lyrics from my old Sony tape recorder. It's one of the other photos. I think it's going to end up in our national traveling exhibit that launches next year. I soon met the rest of the band and included Carl Perkins, famous, like we said, for songs like Blue Suede Shoes, I remembered well from my high school days, and Billings, Montana. And I always loved the Statler Brothers, who reflected my high school days with their songs like The Class of 57 Had Their Dreams. Whatever Happened to Randolph Scott and Hey Good Lookin'. That night the band rehearsed at the Hotel El Rancho, and that's where I learned that John was truly the leader of the band, because he had to tell the Statler Brothers to knock off the goofing around and get down to work. And I'm hoping they haven't edited that out on the new album. I don't have a 78 record player anymore at home, so I haven't even heard the final results of this. So I'm calling, you know, like, I think I'm going to go to Delta College this next Monday to finally get it transcribed down to a DVD so I can find out what, if any, editing was done. If there were only more time, I'd play you that rehearsal. I was only, again, I was the only one who recorded it. It was just, you know, I didn't think anything about it. It was just research to take back for me to do an article. If you go to Nashville and visit the Johnny Cash Museum, you can see the original tape of the actual show that I recorded it along with the original Greystone Chapel demo tape. Just be sure to tell the owner, my friend Bill Miller, that I sent you. Being an inquisitive reporter, while the band was rehearsing, I peeked around the corner of the sliding wall and saw the governor's ball was taking place. And I saw Shirley Temple Black and her husband Charles Black come through the door. My first job out of San Jose State when I got my public relations degree in 1963 was promoting the opening of the Stanford Bank in Palo Alto, where Shirley Temple was on the board of directors. I can't remember if she saw me first or I saw her first, but she asked what I was doing there. So I said I was with Johnny Cash, and would you like to meet him? Oh yeah. So I took her in to meet Johnny Cash, and so Mrs. Black meeting the man in black, you get it?
Yeah.
But a lot of successes are bred first by failures, and that was my biggest photo op failure in my life, not to take a picture of Shirley Temple Black with the man in black. But then there was one bigger. I made a mistake of going to the restroom. And when I came back, they said, Gene, Governor Reagan was here. So apparently Shirley Temple Black had gotten to Governor Reagan, brought him in, or I think they knew each other then. But you know, you look back, at least we got a pretty good batting average, as you can see. And the photographer, my photographer buddy, had gone to bed early. So I think back all these different things that nobody else will ever see. So they think we're very successful. And I look at all the failures we've had. The next morning, we're up early to ride in one of the several black limousines that Columbia Records had rented. We're off to Folsom Prison. I was kind of surprised that it was so far away from our hotel. I had no concept of the area at that time. And maybe it's because they didn't have any nice hotels like this in the city of Folsom in 1968, who knows. Prison officials met us at the bottom of the hill on Prison Road and Folsom Boulevard. They made us get into a rather drab small bus to go the rest of the way up the hill on Prison Road. On the way up, the Statler Brothers were making up jokes and songs and just kept us all laughing. But before we knew it, we were there. So got the photo of John getting out of the bus. We took some photos of John walking around the outside of the prison too, and scored with him, with one of them in front of the prison tower that has become one of the most famous in the world. The volunteer retired correctional officers who run the museum at Folsom Prison tell me people coming from all over the world try and duplicate this pose of John's. One told me that the president of Sony Music was one he saw trying to duplicate this pose. John's, once they opened the gates of the prison on that January 13th historic day and began letting us in, I was carrying that big old Sony tape recorder, and you can imagine how one of the executives of Columbia Records said, "You can't take that in there." But John smiled and said, "Yes, he can. He's my friend, and he's a reporter from Ventura." So that's when I learned who the boss was at Columbia Records. At least they remembered all the cash that cash brought in to Columbia Records. And in the 1960s, I also recall he was outselling Andy Williams, who had a major network TV show. And again, I know a lot of you weren't born then, perhaps. And I worked at NBC when I was a student at UCLA and got to sit in on many of those Andy Williams shows. I have fond memories of that, too. It was a spooky feeling when that big Folsom Prison gate slammed shut. That's when you comprehend how that's probably the sound that stays with many of those prisoners the rest of their lives. After processing us through security, we proceeded through the yard where Cash would greet some of the inmates with, "How you doing?" That put a smile on their faces for sure. Here's one photo of John and June making it look like a stroll through Central Park. And that's been widely published too around the world. Another one of John that might have been taken later in the day between the two shows with myself and LA Times music critic Robert Hilburn walking behind him in the yard. And I think you can almost see that Sony tape recorder that I'm lugging into the prison that day. And Robert Hilburn has written a recent biography called Johnny Cash, The Life. And he also wrote the liner notes for this new 50th anniversary album. Once I got seated in the first row, I was with the rest of the prisoners. And I think Robert Hilburn and Reverend Gressick were standing up. I think they were maybe they were less courageous than, well, Ray Cash and myself were pretty much together. And I thought, I was a little nervous because I thought, what's to prevent these prisoners from grabbing us and creating a riot? And I looked up above and saw this guard with a nice long rifle. And I felt a little bit more at ease from there. The highlight of the day is when John said he was going to sing Greystone Chapel by Glenn Shirley, and watching that prisoner's eyes nearly bug out of his head. "I hope I can do the song justice," he told Shirley. And here's the part of John singing Shirley's song and Glenn Shirley's photo.
"Inside the world of prison, my body may be, but my Lord..."
Get Glenn's photo.
"My soul free. There's a gray stone chapel here at Folsom. A house of worship in this innocent. You wouldn't think that God had a place here at Folsom. But he saved the soul of many."
In addition to printing the article in the Ventura paper, and have we got a slide of that? The first article? Yeah, there it is. That was probably the first article printed in the United States on the event. And that I think will be in our national traveling exhibit. I also found another brave editor in, I think it was Louisville, Kentucky, the Louisville, Kentucky Courier Journal, who bought a magazine article from us for their Sunday magazine section. All the other big magazines, they wouldn't believe me. They just thought I was an over-enthusiastic small-town reporter. And so we forfeited that article for only about $100 for, you know, total for Dan and myself. But I wish I could know if that editor is still alive to compliment him on his foresightedness to take a risk on me. After 50 years, I think we're most proud of the new traveling exhibit that's being produced by ExhibitsUSA in Kansas City. I've worked with them for the past almost year and a half now to select 31 photos and the cover of Life magazine with Johnny Cash on it. That will be, they take a whole year just for the marketing of those photos. to place them in venues. And I'm happy to say one will be close to home here and at the Pence Gallery in Davis. So watch for that. I think it's going to be like 2022 or something. But anyhow, hopefully we'll get some more venues close to home here, close to Folsom. I get a lot of questions saying, what kind of a man was Johnny Cash? I found him to be an intellectual, which surprises a lot of people. When I was hired by 20th Century Fox to help them promote the movie I Walk the Line, and I'd be talking to someone in foreign countries, and they would ask this question, and I'd say, well, you know, he even wrote a novel called The Man in White. Oh, really? But when we'd be in, like, traveling in a limousine or something, he'd probably be reading the Wall Street Journal or Time Magazine, and that kind of surprised me at first, but not afterwards. And we used to have to think how many songs he wrote and the lyrics. I mean, it was like a great poet, really. And as most people know, June Carter became his angel that helped turn his drug addiction around. And they had a successful marriage that lasted until both of them died 6 months apart. June died May 15, 2003, and John died September 12, 2003. And that's when all the media that turned me down for so many years started calling me that night for photos, which I found kind of disgusting. And I turned it over to the Associated Press to be our agent at that time, and that's where we still get royalties from, as I told you. One of my favorite shows that John performed in was, in addition to Folsom, was at Madison Square Garden in 1969, where he told the time he took his entire band to Vietnam. And he told the audience how he had this reporter friend, referring to myself, who asked him, well, doesn't that make you a hawk? When you go to see the wounded boys, maybe that makes me a dove with claws. That was his answer. Now, are there any questions? I mean, questions that I can give answers to? We have a Q&A period here if you want to fire any questions at me. Okay.
Did he record that prisoner's song, or was that ever?
Yes.
What happened with that?
Yes, that's, like I say, when he told, Glenn Shirley was sitting in one of the first or second row, and when he told him, Glenn, I hope I do justice to your song, and he sung the song, and Glenn just jumped out of the seat, you know, and his eyes were bulging out of his head, and there's quite a backstory from there. John actually got Glenn Shirley, the author of that song and the man who sang it on the demo tape, he got him pardoned later and hired him, and he was on his show for a while. I saw him perform in Anaheim, and the trouble is, he looked out of place with all the seasoned performers that had done their dues for so many years, and then his downfall was he threatened the life of one of the band members. He threatened to kill him. So that was the end of his career with Johnny Cash. And then Glenn Shirley ended up committing suicide. And I'm quite amazed that someone hasn't done a TV show, say a 30-minute hour TV show on Glenn Shirley. And there has been some this year, some stories on it. And in the liner notes, I noticed that Bob Hilburn did quite an in-depth thing on Glenn Shirley, more than I've seen so far. John, I saw John in an airport once when I had another business at that time, and I happened to run across John and June in an airport, and I asked them about it, and it was very evident they didn't want to talk about it. And I've heard the rest of the Cash family doesn't like to talk about it either, so I was surprised to see it in the Sony album. You can read about it there if you happen to buy the album. Any other questions? Well, I'm going to seize on the opportunity here to thank some of my local San Joaquin tax assessors for some courtesies that they've given me personally over the past few years. And if I've got names of three that might be here. Steve, and I'm going to butcher your names, so forgive me. Steve Bestelardis, is he here?
Steve Bestelardis, he is here, but I think he has stepped out.
Okay. Karen Johnson, would you stand up? And Wakar Rizvi, I'm probably really butchering that name.
Wakar will be here tomorrow.
Okay. Well, you can take the word back to them. It's kind of ironic that my pet peeve is my property taxes. My property taxes are up to $4,200 in our retirement condo now, but anyhow, I'm the first to realize that you guys did not create the law. That's become a two-headed monster for people like myself when Prop 13 was created back in the 1970s. And no one ever dreamed that average homes would be more than $200,000, $300,000, or even up to $1 million. And I just wanted to thank these people publicly because I'm sure they don't get enough thanks in their work, in their daily work, right? So, last year when I wrote a letter to the editor of our local record newspaper saying I'm not very good in math, so could someone please explain to me how my property taxes have nearly doubled in just over 10 years? The morning it was published, I got a call about 8 a.m. from a wonderful tax appraiser woman in our San Joaquin County Assessor's Office. She said, Gene, I'll tell you why. It's the bond issues. And she named every one of them, starting with our Unified School District, Delta College, and right down to the Mosquito Abatement Act. I've since done some research on Delta Colleges and found out that they were going to expand to Galt and Mountain House and other places. And they spent millions of dollars in that goal, but then they backed out, decided it was a bad idea. At least they had the guts to admit it to the press. But you know us lowly taxpayers aren't going to get a refund for their huge mistakes. And again, I feel I have friends in our local tax office, which may make our neighbors feel like I'm either the strangest guy on our block or luckiest guy on our block. To conclude, when Janelle first called me, she said she and your organization wanted something different for a speaker. So I'll let you vote on whether Janelle succeeded. Thanks again for inviting me. I wanted to say one more thing. I have to leave at about 1:30 to go back to Folsom Prison. Talk about serendipity today. I've been invited to another concert within the walls of Folsom Prison starting at 4:00 today, and I'm to report that at 2:00. So I wanted your next speaker to know that I'm not going to leave because of her speech. But it's interesting. It's a Latino group this time. And they say there's over 50% of Latinos in the prison now, so that's why they chose that band. And I don't even speak Spanish, but my friend at the Wall Street Journal has asked me to compare the original concert with today's. That's why I'm going.
Thank you, Gene.
I hear the train a-coming, it's rolling around the bend. Coming down that railroad track. Hey, look, I'm coming. Coming down that railroad track. It's that orange blossom special, bringing my baby back.